experiences. And we also think there are some differences actually in the approaches. But first of all, I want to give you a quote, a very short one, by a professor who was a long time my professor at the university. He's an artist himself, and he always said, every skill is ideological. And I kind of want to ask you if you somehow can relate to that. Every skill is ideological.
Well, I'll let you pick apart the meaning ideological for me, and then I'll start to answer that.
I think it's quite...
I take a long time to think about it.
That's actually, we have
well,
50
I
minutes.
Well, I just launch in and,
yeah,
then,
and then I
mm-hmm.
respond
because,
later.
And respond intuitively. But, you know, in working with Alva, Noe, our
mm-hmm.
philosopher we work with, talks a lot about skills and habits of perception.
Mm-hmm.
And that
mm-hmm.
this way that the ways that we learn to take in the world and see the world and be in the world or listen to the world are our skills.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, the ways that we learn to perceive, I think, become ideological. The ways that our skills are limited
mm-hmm.
or facilitated, or who is allowed to move in what ways, who is
mm-hmm.
Supported to move or be or act in the world, is of course ideological and sets up parameters for what is valued and what is not valued
mm-hmm.
in society.
So that will be normal and
or even possible, you
mm-hmm.
know, normal, possible,
mm-hmm.
good, bad,
or even just seen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. To be seen. To
be just seen. I mean, that's
yeah.
a lot about visibility, I think, also.
Uh-huh.
For
sure.
We kind of thought about... Yeah, we talked actually after your piece a lot about the Cunningham technique. Someone had stolen that
Claire
name.
Cunningham
huh?
technique, yeah.
I mean, and how far is it a technique or not? Or a style,
yeah.
like an individual style? Because what we understood from your brilliant performance was the other day that, yeah, also we read it on the internet, and I think you say it in the piece, huh?
Yeah.
A part of that style
mm-hmm.
is do nothing what hurts you. huh?
yeah.
mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
seems to be quite normal, but
mm-hmm.
we know a lot of dance techniques, even we,
yeah, yeah. even
where
me
a lot of things
yeah.
are hurtful.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Yeah? Yeah.
So how,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's maybe, I mean, I don't always take my own I don't always take my own medicine in that regard,
yeah.
or my own rules, you know. I think for me, yeah, there's a question around what you decide for yourself and what you choose to direct others to do would make me feel very different.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
as a choreographer, I'm not interested in asking someone to do something that hurts them. Whether I choose to do that for my own body,
mm-hmm.
I think would feel different. When I made solo work, I might push myself somewhere
mm-hmm.
there, but... but yeah, I, at the same time, maybe there being a different level of, or just maybe a different relationship to how far you're willing to go in terms of the impact that
mm-hmm.
has on your life outside that studio and that dance world or that dance school. And I think coming into dance, that was quite frightening to watch how young dancers, really to
yeah.
or become so the necessity to do whatever is asked of them
mm-hmm.
uh-huh.
especially when young of not realizing or not being empowered to question
yes.
those things
16 sometimes even younger
yeah.
than a child by later
in
well.
Or
yeah,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
and still in their 20s you know in many
mm-hmm.
companies and environments really
yeah.
not empowered to say actually dropping to my knees on a concrete floor for you
mm-hmm.
20 times actually I don't know the choice
know.
Of asking someone to do that I find questionable
yeah.
you know
yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that yes that's fine right now but in 20 years that
yeah.
might have an impact and I guess
mm-hmm.
these are places where you know from my perspective the lived experience of disability you maybe grow up with or gain a need to kind of have a wider perspective
mm-hmm.
on the impact things might have on your body or have had to develop a greater attunement to your own body
mm-hmm.
and what happens to it and what's how it's going to change, mm-hmm. and then maybe a different awareness of how it might change. That I think, yeah, sometimes in these, particularly in training establishments and in some company structures, don't allow for anything beyond that project you are in right
mm-hmm.
now.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, yeah, I mean, I think I enjoyed that very much when I first worked with Jess in an ensemble work. That was the first, this feeling, this sense when you came into the rehearsal room for the first time, that there was a real understanding that life didn't stop at the door.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't
yeah.
like you walked in the door, you were a professional performer, and you, yeah, like everything that happens in your life affects what happens in that room, and vice versa, actually.
Like the sound you're doing in the venues.
Now
I'm different.
Yeah.
And this, of course, relates again to this question of ideology,
mm-hmm.
because, yeah, it defines. This is why we talked about technique. Huh? It's not learning a technique in your case, but exploring or developing an own. And funnily, kind of you teach him the technique during the performance.
Yeah.
So is it more a technique to teach, or is it more the idea of develop your own style, like in performance art or so?
I think those things depend on what choices you make,
mm-hmm.
in terms of like, do you choose to spend time working on a certain thing? Like, there are certain things that are absolutely part of the way that I work with crutches, that is because I live with them for 26 years, you know, in terms of my understanding of their spatial awareness and where they end and these things.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the choice to kind of go, okay, well, actually, I'm going to practice knowing exactly where that is, and I'm going to spend time in a studio doing, you know, an exercise of this
mm-hmm.
over and over again
mm-hmm.
to really learn exactly where that point is, you know, and that when maybe that this shifts into something more
mm-hmm.
like technique,
mm-hmm.
like the choice to actually work at something and refine it in
mm-hmm.
a specific way. There are things that become skills that you develop in the world, and then whether something then becomes a very specific technique that you do in a specific way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And yeah, does it become something teachable? I don't know in that respect. I don't know. I don't think that when something like this is where, I guess, especially when we recognize the distinctly different bodies that everyone has,
mm-hmm.
then things become questionable of like, yeah, I'm not sure I can teach exactly that thing
yeah.
to someone, because it will manifest differently in someone with the different proportions.
Mm-hmm.
To
well, as we
different
say,
hasn't 26 years of evolving a particular musculature
mm-hmm.
and balance and, yeah,
and like we
sensorial
say
relationship.
In the piece, this moment, Claire does the swing through.
Yes.
And
yeah.
for my body,
mm-hmm.
it's an incredibly difficult move
mm-hmm.
that hurts my wrist, actually.
Yeah.
A bit.
Yeah.
I mean, I have some arthritis in my wrist. But it's like, oh,
yeah.
this is really a different thing for my arms and
mm-hmm.
my arm strength. And I have much more mass
mm-hmm.
hanging
yeah.
from my shoulders
mm-hmm.
when I do that. So, but I wanted to actually also mention, in terms of technique,
yeah.
that things don't come out of nowhere. Like, actually,
yeah, yeah.
Claire also worked a bunch with Bill Shannon.
Yeah,
yeah,
and,
okay.
And there are techniques that are maybe...
But that notion of training it as
mm-hmm.
technique comes from spending time with Bill. I wouldn't
yeah.
have thought about,
mm-hmm.
oh, actually,
mm-hmm.
I can do this cleaner and better
mm-hmm.
unless I'd worked with Bill. So
and I think
really
there
yeah.
are techniques of making and techniques of training and ways of thinking of technique as not just a specific move.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not just that I, you know, I have to learn the Cunningham etudes to do dancing, but there are principles underneath those
yeah.
that might work differently for different bodies.
So it's material.
So it's material. Yeah. But I'm sorry.
Yeah. Is it something you work with, not you learn? But
well,
you
or the thing, the technique might also be a technique of questioning
mm,
or a technique
yeah.
of generating.
Yes.
Or those are also techniques that are not just making a codified
yeah.
system
mm-hmm.
of gestures that you then reiterate
mm-hmm.
in other bodies.
Yeah.
Cunningham didn't.
Yeah.
He came out of Martha Graham,
yes.
and he didn't keep doing Graham technique. He did the thing that he did, but then he was kind of brilliant, and a lot of people said, "Oh, we'll just keep copying
yes.
him," and that is great, maybe in some ways, but that's not what he did.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't, you know, he didn't just copy. Otherwise, he would just be, would have kept doing Graham technique.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
there's, I think, that progression and the technique of invention or the technique of exploration or the technique of research is also technique.
Yeah, but is maybe also the questioning of given structures, techniques, also maybe a new technique? Like,
yeah,
is it like the principle of my technique is the questioning? Questioning in itself is is a tool maybe to, to do something.
But much more flexible. Ah, it's not a fixed system. It's something you have to choose to change with different bodies, with different cultural environments, different weather even. It's I think it's not such a it's not a religion anymore, not a discipline in that case.
Yeah, I mean, I think technique, I'm trying to think back to, it's been a while since I, like, the root of the word technique, the Greek.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, it's around the doing or a tool something.
Tool, yes.
And there's something about how, what are the tools that we use, and that I think is very relevant, and that different bodies require different tools, different outcomes, different goals require different tools.
Mm-hmm.
So that the tools more that are more flexible offer more flexible outcomes. But you know, if you have a really particular thing that you really want to do, then you maybe you only want one technique, but that leads to, I don't know, a friend of mine got kicked out of the, she was at La Scala Ballet until she was about 14, and then she got 1 inch too tall, and so she got kicked out, because you, in the Scala Ballet, to be in the corps, you can only be this tall, and you have to be this tall, and you have to have, you know, and it's like, you have to have this exact body, or it doesn't, so.
Yeah, and it's also a limitation to aesthetics, I think, so this is,
for sure.
Yeah.
We keep moving?
Maybe keep moving, but
and
get out of the wind.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I can walk much, because I still I have to walk back, so I have to, I have to be assessing the energy all the time of like, if I walk this far, I also have to walk this far back.
Yeah. It's also, you find over the weak spot of this format, walk and talk, it's going somewhere, and then being somewhere, and how do we get that?
Yeah, I'm always having to think, how I get that?
I mean, it's a wide range.
I'm quite impressed by the skill and technique of our camera.
Yeah, yes, eyes and her back head.
You suggested to speak about disability and art discourses in UK, in the US, and in Germany, and somehow also the differences, or the what is like, are there like really different approaches, or what is in common, and so, and I, because I'm not really familiar with the discourses in UK and US, maybe you can speak a little bit about
I think I can maybe just talk a little bit about the kind of the framework in which it's sort of evolved, more than the discourse maybe at the moment, but I think there's certain ways in which the UK has kind of there's been quite a lot of progress and support of the development of disabled artists, and work with and by disabled artists, and there's this, and it's quite, it's still relatively unusual in the world in terms of how far things have been able to progress, which is so, which is very rooted in a couple of things, such as the fact that there's quite a strong history of community arts work in the UK that came out of the Second World War, and this sort of where the NHS also grew out of, the same sort of time of recovery from that, and sort of this notion of arts being accessible for all people and all classes, and the potential for being involved in arts, that I think meant that there was a bit more sort of notion of participatory activities, which doesn't mean that they were often always that accessible to disabled people, but it meant that occasionally there were places where disabled people had engaged with local groups, and so the possibility then of being in a local youth drama company or something meant that people began to realise, I'd like to do this as a career, so people kind of began to have the chance to sort of have those notions that these were possibilities sort of proposed to them.
But does it also come from an activist background?
I have the impression that this is more this kind of approach from the UK. Yeah, so these two things, there's this history of sort of community arts that exists, and then the fact that there was a very strong disability rights movement in the UK. And what's significant in the UK disability rights is that it was led by people who were disabled quite often from birth. Which has a different, there's a different trajectory, for example, in the US, where the not entirely, but a lot of the disability rights movement in the US was led by veterans
post-Vietnam,
which is a different narrative of people
who were
non-disabled and who acquired acquired disability. And so that trajectory has is infused a bit with a narrative of heroism, loss, tragedy.
That's completely another way.
And also guilt, huh? Someone can make responsible.
It informs it in a different way, and it kind of publicly kind of has put disability arts in quite a harder place to work from. Whereas the UK scene was coming from people who were like, we want equal rights. We haven't had access to these things from birth. At the start, we people that were segregated in education were put away in institutions. People that were fighting for the right to be allowed to actually just live in society. So it's informed from an equal rights perspective, in that sense of like, well, actually, yeah, if you can go to a dance class, then I have a right to go to a dance class. And so it has been pushed by quite a political sort of motivation in a lot of these first companies.
Yeah,
like
that's true.
Grey Eye, there's Dada Fest in Liverpool. Again, quite a sort of, you know, sort of politically activist city, and quite socialist sort of values of equality. And so that,
okay,
I think,
sound-wise?
Is part of why the UK.
Just wear them out.
I have the impression that in Germany it comes like from a different side. There are a lot of companies actually in Germany that are groups with people that have mental disabilities. So there's Theater Tikva, there's Theater Rambazamba in Switzerland,
you
have Theater Hora, and this is a completely different point of starting point, I think, for the approach to doing art. It's maybe coming more from a pedagogical way. It's not like we are speaking for ourselves, it's like some other people say we want this people to be integrated in like a normalized society kind of. So this
I think this is a little what Claire's talking about in the UK with this idea of community art
that
is a kind of social good therapeutic experience.
One aspect,
has been and is also in the States
valuable,
been that kind of like this is good for people and it's good for everyone to do art and I think the difference is that in the UK you really had then this evolution of really professional disabled artists and training programs, professional training programs, and that
very strong voices
and that are very much led by disabled people.
I think this is the main difference, because I think the groups in Germany, they are not led by.
But you have a number of also Dina 13, Gerda König is a disabled led company, and I think it's tricky when cognitive disability versus
it's always put in one.
That is,
thing.
I think, one step of the discourse that I think is really important to distinguish. Different blind artists have different needs and abilities, and then deaf artists and people who use crutches have different capacities than people who use wheelchairs. All of those things are very different, and to lump everyone into this
disability
category doesn't serve that.
It's hugely difficult and problematic because
it's
one ridiculously big umbrella that you know,
that
so many people are kind of shepherded under. And yeah, actually in the UK I think it's been problematic in the other direction, and I think that, you know, there are hierarchies that then appear within disability sort of structures as well, of like actually a lot of the work by disabled artists has then come from more people, like, you know, people with physical impairments who've still been able to access education, etc. And there's still at some moments, yeah, the work for learning disabled artists, there's sometimes not been as much support for that work to be led by disabled artists in that same way. But then you know it's actually possible if really you get the right people in place. When you look at people like Back to Back, theatre company from Australia,
but they're
like,
still
that's
led by a non-disabled artist.
Yeah, well, yeah, but in ways
who's
that is about really about empowering those individuals to creatively, I think, lead the ideas.
Yeah, because
so
and I think that's
leadership.
The distinction, you know, has been sometimes about what the issue historically in the sort of more community arts environments, where quite often that non-disabled people were leading those environments, but they weren't often individuals who had worked professionally as artists, maybe had a huge experience in that, so they couldn't take people further,
awesome.
you know, into making really good quality art. So they could only take people so far, so the intentions were good. And as social environments and the right of people to be in arts activities and that enjoyment for everyone. But sometimes the problem was the potential to really professionally develop people. The people who were leading those groups didn't have that experience themselves as artists
that's
to take people further.
Artist,
yeah. So yeah, it's been about finding ways that, and also the reality of who genuinely has the potential, you know, and not just going, all these disabled people should be professional artists. It's like, actually, the people who genuinely want to do that and have the capacity to do that, that's always needles in haystacks. You know, it's small numbers of people, and how do you take that person out and put them?
And it becomes
further?
Complicated in the same way that it comes,
like
you're still start valuing some people
over
other people and going, oh, this person is, I mean, I don't know, I love one of Claire's, my favorite quotes from Claire on a panel. She said, in London, where he said, I know, I'm a palatable crip.
Yeah.
Like, I'm cute and articulate.
I never said
palatable.
I was cute.
You didn't say you're cute. Sorry.
What does palatable mean?
So palatable means easy to digest.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I was talking about the fact that, I'm an accessible crip for non-disabled people.
I mean, I have
a relatively normative body. I'm white. I've had a university education. I can communicate verbally.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have lots of things in that regard. I'm not speaking with, I don't
I
have to speak with sign language. I can communicate with everyone around me. I can see you, I can hear you.
I know
so
what you mean.
So that makes me,
I
think my job in environments sometimes like this is that I, as I said at that platform, my job is to open the door and jam a crutch in it for all the other crips to get through behind me. You know, that I can be a stepping stone for certain people to realise that, oh, wait a minute, there is these whole lived experiences that can really give us new insights into what art can say in the world.
And
the disability isn't this irrelevant thing if you're not disabled. But there's a tendency to people, I think, programmers, etc., and society in general, to think that disability isn't relevant to you if you don't consider yourself disabled. And it's like, actually, it's life, you know. You know, it's like it's you know, it's love, it's paying a mortgage, it's, you know, riding a bike or not riding a bike, you know, it's going to the supermarket.
If you take it brighter, you can when you take disability as a brighter notion, it is in everybody's life, actually, in more or less ways. Can you say that, or
it's tricky to say a little bit. I mean, I think disability, identifying as disabled or is also political, and I don't think we're all the same. I don't identify as disabled. I learn from being in relationship to disabled artists and disabled people. I have learned an amazing amount about my body, and I think there are lessons around bodies are changing and bodies have different capacities at different times. for the last year, for the last 6 months, I was walking with a cane because I had arthritis in my hip, but now I'm not needing that. So there's a kind of permeability to that that I think is important and different, but it is sort of tricky to say.
I think it is. It would be false to say we are all disabled somehow, because it is not.
It's making it apolitical.
It's not even apolitical because it is not like that.
It's a little bit like the all lives matter kind of conundrum.
Exactly. It's tricky to say that.
Sometimes people like to say, oh, you know, if I didn't have my glasses, then I would be. I can't see as well, therefore I am disabled, and none, you know, and it's like, actually that is not the same as being disabled. Actually, it doesn't affect your choices in life, and the opportunities open to you. Well, maybe you can't be a fighter pilot because you wear glasses, but it doesn't affect how you're viewed in society to the degree that it oppresses you at the same time. So disability
is
about oppression.
It's about
not speaking a language, limits your capacity in a certain context, but it's not the same as being disabled.
And there's also the sort of, coming back a little bit to the levels of discourse or kinds of discourse, one of the important discourses that comes out, and I don't know if it's original, I know it more from Britain than, and it was introduced to me, and but I know it starts to be more in play in the States, and is the social model of disability. Then the idea that that disability and referring to oneself or identifying as disabled, like in the social model, one is disabled by society. That disability is not a matter of medical impairment or or a diagnosis. That disability is, as a friend of mine, Kaz Langley, once said. Kaz is a wheelchair user, and she said, I would never build a house with stairs. The stairs disable me. And that's the essence of the social model, to say the construct in society that deny access are what disabled people. And so that there's this kind of bright line in America. So just back to differences in discourse when we were touring in America. In America, even the languaging of it, the way people speak, it's very popular still to use what's called people-first language, which is to say, I am a person with a disability.
Is what we discussed today.
Yeah.
This is completely something different to say.
Well, and it's an ideological choice.
Isn't it one shade of your personality?
Yes.
But not like defining you.
But on the other hand, that to identify, I mean, I would let Claire speak to it more, but my friends, and I feel like I even watched Claire, you sort of made a transition in this when our first show, I think you identified as an artist with a disability.
Yeah.
And then by the second or third project we did together, Claire was like, no, I'm a disabled artist.
Mm-hmm.
I want to identify.
Yeah,
that's what your website is saying. Huh?
Yeah.
And also recognizing that it actually was shaping the art that I made. That was not beginning to understand that distinction.
We go back this way?
We are nearly big, actually.
Yeah, we are nearly big. But also that thing of people first language also being related to, for some people, they're still it's still a situation where the disability is a negative thing for them. That they're like, why would I want to put that out there first? Mm-hmm. And so, as long as disability is still presented in society and they are living in an environment where disability is a negative experience for them and a source of shame, which is a really important aspect of knowledge around disability, then the understanding of why you want, people that say, I don't like the word disabled, I don't want to use it, and lots of conversations about language, and it's like, if you're in an environment where that is, absolutely still be a negative experience for you, then I can understand why you don't want to take that word on. But partly for me, and we go back to your thing about visibility, partly for me, I state that I'm a disabled artist, a disabled person, because I think it's important to make it visible and say, this isn't a shameful thing for me. It's an aspect of who I am and what it offers in the world for me, actually. somebody will come up with something different and new and beautiful, and that will change in 5 years for me as well. But yeah, for me, it's like if I continue to put it out there as a positive force, then hopefully that also starts to shift that and removes the shame from that association of that word.
Yeah.
But
then
in a utopian society, would you not maybe define yourself anymore? Or would it also, could you imagine doing something that is just like away from this topic?
I don't know because it's intrinsically part of my life. I can't remove it away from my, you know, all my work. Doesn't mean everything I make is always about it, but it's always infused by that experience.
Yeah, that's...
And the scary thing quite often when people write, you know, sci-fi and utopian ideas, quite often disability doesn't exist, you know, in these notions of utopia.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, well, I want a crip utopia, a queer utopia.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, what are all these utopias that are about all these ways of being?
But it might be
boring utopia, and this is why I like the idea of having varieties.
Well, and I think that for me, there's somewhere where the utopian vision might be that if disability is caused by societies throwing up boundaries that deny people access, then the utopia would be that society no longer is disabling people, but Claire would still be an artist with a particular physicality who makes dances with crutches.
And I think
when we're in at Unlimited, which is the big festival of disabled artists in London that co-commissioned our piece, nobody in the bar at Unlimited is talking about whether they're disabled or not.
No.
You know,
really?
It's like, oh, well, look at so-and-so's new wheelchair, or look at so-and-so, you know, that they're people with a variety of hair and a variety of outfits.
Yeah.
And
they're just people that
have a diverse bodies and diverse ways of being in the world. And
talking more about...
Yeah. So
laid, or you know, these things are not even talked about wheelchairs half the time.
Yeah,
we're talking about.
Do you
have you
more
got enough? Are you working? Have you got any work? Did you pay the rent? You know, who are you dating? You know, it's actually, you know, how's your son?
Yeah,
you know, that these are actually what people are talking about as well.
It is. I don't know if we're. Are we close to?
We are way over time.
Okay.
You know, that
one
can
thing
that's
well,
gonna cut it out. So
we talk. Yeah, we're like, what are we talking about for half an hour? It's like, oh god, we can talk. But one, I don't know, and maybe not to dig, but to say one of the impressions I had being here,
mm-hmm.
in this context was, and particularly in comparison to being in the UK, and when I think especially of the Unlimited, but Unlimited is a very particular
mm-hmm.
festival, but. Is that there are no visibly disabled administrators or curators or
there's
pretty
no
much
real expectation
even not so many spectators, huh?
Or spectators. Yeah,
yeah.
When mostly when we perform, there are almost always a few people in wheelchairs coming to, and this is also a special environment.
I get it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it feels like there maybe wasn't an expectation
mm-hmm.
of that here
mm-hmm.
as well. And I think you know we were talking to we did the interview just before this, you know, about, you know, like what it is to, you know, bring work that has different bodies and start to question who can dance.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like also like the important thing to start bringing to places like this is like, who are your audiences?
Mm-hmm.
And they're not all normative bodied, all seeing, all hearing, all jumping, all climbing stairs people, you know.
Yeah. Or unfortunately, they are right
but
now,
they,
but they don't
yeah,
need to
but
be.
They shouldn't be because art is supposed to be for societies, and societies are not young, skinny, 20-year-olds who can jump, and all, you know, that's not actually the majority of the world's population. It's just those people.
But still, in dance, I mean, the
people
majority
are making,
yeah.
and the problem,
yeah,
for me,
yes.
people make, and a lot, most choreographers make work for audiences that they project and presume will have bodies like them. So people who can stand for a long time, people who can see everything, people who can hear everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly.
There's, you know, there's no expectation of others' needs
mm-hmm.
and different ways of being in the world, and that's
yeah.
Yeah. You know, that's like the space that you come into in our performance is that thing of like, you can choose where you want to sit, you know, because you might not be comfortable sitting right in the middle of the stage, you might not want to sit on the floor, you might want to sit out and not be touched, you know, or you might want to sit closer because you have a visual impairment and you want to feel the movement, you know, that where are the choices being given for audiences and that suit their bodies as well, not just who's on the stage. But
this is the moment where we have to decide if you make a series out of it. So two is coming up. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Your time. Very good talk.
Thank you.
Yeah, now we go inside and have a tea. Yeah.